broadcasting live from the beautiful Norman P. Murray Community Center in Mission Viejo, where they now have their own farmer's market. It's Breakfast with Gary and Kelly and special guest Craig Chaquico.
It's Breakfast with Gary and Kelly, everybody. Now featuring new props. Our budget went up. Oh, my God. Not much.
No, this was my Christmas present from...
Stop poking. You know, I get poked with... Never mind.
That's okay.
We're glad you guys are here. This is the first show of our second season. This is unbelievable.
They kept us on.
When you think about, you know, the shows that have not made it through just a couple, and here we are.
We're still going strong.
I know. I think, you know, are you like me? Has this changed your life?
No. He got recognized at the store the other day.
I did.
I couldn't believe it.
I did.
A lady, never get recognized.
I know. A lady said, "Move your cart, sir." And I went, "Oh, you've seen the show." No, and I got approved. No, not really. I did get approved for the Ralph's Club card, though, and I'm sure that's why.
Really? It's,
yeah, finally I got approved for that. So that's a good thing.
We got that going for us. Okay, thank you very much.
Well, thank you all for joining us.
I'll point at him.
We have somebody here that...
We're going to rock it out today. That's why
started
the
started in the rock world, I believe.
He did.
But now he's has his own name in the genre of jazz.
Whoa.
So why don't you...
The heck you say? Yeah, this is why we're all here today. And we are thrilled that this guy... We're thrilled that he got up this early. This is very early for people like him. But we're glad he's here. We're glad you're here. Please, ladies and gentlemen, welcome Craig Chaquico.
Thank you.
Breakfast with Gary and Kelly. On SM 88.5 KSPR and MVTV Channel 30 and all that good stuff. Craig Chaquico is our guest, dude.
Right, you gotta love it so much. Thank you.
All right, now look, here's the thing. I know this is really early for you, and I understand, and it is breakfast. So Kevin stole from his hotel room. Here's the Jimmy Dean sausage, egg, and cheese muffin breakfast thing. So if in case, just in case, you know.
Does it have to be heated?
You probably want I have a lighter if you want, but it's probably better.
The date is like 1963 on this.
Well,
man.
Sure. I mean,
they last. They last for a while.
Well, exactly right. And this is a low-budget kind of show, too. So always keep that in mind.
Yeah, well, I appreciate it. I got breakfast. I was wondering what we were going to have for breakfast.
See, it's called Breakfast with Gary and Kelly.
Nice. Thank you.
Thanks so much for being here.
Oh, man, it's my pleasure, Gary. I mean, going back to when my first album came out, it's almost 20 years now.
Isn't that crazy?
And you guys were one of the first people to play it, you know. So it's like I feel like we're part of the family. You know, you sort of got the ball rolling.
And
you're all part of the family, big time.
Exactly.
If it wasn't for you, we wouldn't be here. So
exactly.
Yeah.
That really is almost 20 years ago. Isn't that crazy?
I know.
Where does it go? Well, you know, and I got going out of the other room over there, so that's, you know.
I know.
We're
you've
all
got the next,
getting old,
you've
baby.
Got the next generation coming, you know, right behind you, man. Next to,
you know, yeah. What? I'm going to do this right now. I was going to hold off, but I think this is a good time to start on this.
Oh, so we're going to surprise the guests.
There's
with
a couple
like old
things.
Photos.
No,
okay.
We're going to go back in time.
Let's
take a walk.
Look at this
we?
One from Guitar Player Magazine. Look at this thing.
I
mean, look at that guy.
Is that you?
Look at that guitar you're toting there. That is, what year is this? Do you have any clue?
I'm going to say it's probably late 70s, early 80s maybe. Or
there's a date up on the top, Gary.
Well, there's that too.
You know, you can Photoshop those things. That isn't really me. That was
thanks a lot. That's why Kelly is here, everybody. 1982.
That's not that long ago.
Isn't that something?
Yeah, it
that's
is.
So
amazing.
All right,
yeah.
Now here's the one. Here's my question.
Oh, I love this
one. My question for you. Which comes first on something like this? Do you get the pants and have them make the guitar to match? Or how does that work exactly?
You know, this is really good because no one's ever asked me that question. And I think it's a really good question. The guitar itself was like one of those days in the hotel room, you know, that you had nothing to do. And
you didn't take a Sharpie to it, did you?
Well, you know what? The pants are a Sharpie.
No.
Yeah. No, yeah. Did you really?
Totally.
Seriously?
Totally. I didn't buy those. I sat there
you
and looked at them.
Up?
I did. And then I'm really revealing a lot.
You're doing good. But
the guitar itself, the stripes were done with like silver gaffer's tape. And
really?
Yeah, and,
wow.
You know, and it ended up at a hard rock somewhere, and I've had people come up going, "Man, that was so cool how you had those silver stripes inlaid
to the
guitar."
You should go into the designing business for clothes.
Yeah, I know. I mean, it's not silver; it's just the tape. You know, and they thought it was like
it's another
silver.
Career for you.
I'm ready.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
And look at the wall of sound behind you, man.
No, that was what brought a lot of the sound to the stage, man. Yeah. That was Carmen and I go way back. They made this guitar for me. This is my own. Design, you know, so I've been playing their guitars forever for, you know.
I'm thinking this is also part of the reason that the family might have said, could you turn it down and start playing something lighter?
Yeah, well, we actually had the idea of taking some of those cabinets and taking the speakers out and putting a refrigerator back there with some.
See?
You know.
A little snack?
Yeah.
How about this one? Now, there's no date on this, Kelly.
Well, it's not a
but this
cover.
Is this is a great one, huh? With Grace?
Yeah,
I
remember that photo shoot. I was like, God,
Which one is you?
I'm the guy behind Grace there with a big smile.
Right
on
there. Face. Yeah. Right there.
Okay.
That would be me.
Sorry, I can't
any,
see that.
Any idea how old you were?
Oh, gosh. You know, if that was like late 70s, you know, I joined the band when I was still a teenager, so I was probably like early 20s or something.
Crazy.
And the last one.
This one I love. This is such a great picture.
Did you Sharpie her jacket too?
No, that was actually a designer.
That's a great
moment.
Shot. You really look young there too. Isn't
Boy,
that?
Yeah.
Well, I think he still looks young.
No, he does. No question about it. But oh man, and you and Grace kind of have the matching hair thing going on a little bit.
Yeah, I never noticed that until you just mentioned that. That's true.
That's
yeah.
a great shot.
Yeah,
that's
I
a
don't
great
think
shot.
You changed much except for that you have shorter hair.
You're too kind.
No,
thanks.
Seriously, you really haven't. I think you have.
Talk to us. Let's go back to the whole story about.
I don't think we talked about it when you were, when we chatted last in November, but the whole thing with your accident, and how old were you when you were bedridden?
I was 12 years old, and there's a picture of me in my on my webpage with both my arms in casts. Oh, I broke my thumb, my wrist, my arm, both arms, my leg, my ankle, my foot.
What happened again?
A drunk driver hit me and my dad in the family car. You know, so 1 minute I'm a like normal kid,
12-year-old.
Yeah, riding my bicycle around, and the next minute I'm in this car, and this car crash, and I wake up in the hospital a couple of days later, and I have all these casts, you know. And so my doctor allowed me to still play my guitar, even though my fingers only stuck out about an inch from the cast. Mm-hmm. She knew that it would be good for my circulation, you know, probably that it would be good for my soul and my spirit. So she encouraged me to play, and I ended up actually writing a song on one string, because it was the only string I could reach with my fingers in the cast. And because it was the E string and my doctor's name was Elizabeth, I called it Elizabeth's Song, and it ended up on a Grammy-nominated album of mine 30 years later. So.
And that was when you were 12?
Yeah, that was when I was 12.
Wow.
Yeah, it was a little...
So that was like the start of your writing career?
That's a little part of the song.
So, wow.
In case you're wondering why that guy only plays on one string, that was the way it was written.
So the casts that were in your hands, you did that while you had casts
on? Yeah, only on one string though.
I know, but visualize casts on his hands.
Yeah. Yeah, no, it actually fit pretty good.
And please don't grab the guest, Kelly, please.
And this hand was enough that I could still play the one string, you know.
Wow. And so where is Elizabeth today?
You know, that's a great question, because we did a concert in Sedona, and there was a lady that was like a private eye, and she had tracked down...
Oh, I've had that happen.
She tracked down my doctor, Elizabeth, because I went back to the hospital when I was a kid to play, and she had already left. I mean, she was a woman doctor, very young at the time, and then over the years, you know, she retired, and it was kind of hard to find her. But this private eye found her, and we called her backstage from the concert in Sedona. And, I mean, I don't even know if she likes guitar music, but I told her it's all her fault.
Does she know about the song?
I told her about it.
Yeah.
You know, and we played it
in
concert. Yeah, yeah. She goes, I like saxophone better, but I, you know.
No.
Great.
But yeah, that was my doctor.
Everybody's a critic.
You know.
Yeah. No, she was very, very supportive, and you know, the song was all on the E string, and her name was Elizabeth, so I called it Elizabeth's Song. Yeah. And whether she liked it or not, she heard that song a lot.
How long were you bedridden like that?
About 3 months, you know. It wasn't as long as you would think. And there's a picture of me in the hospital with a big smile on my face, you know, and it's because I probably have my guitar in my hand. But then I also started thinking about those little white pills that they would come in the nursery. You know, years later, I went, why am I so happy? I mean, I was very lucky. You know, when you're young, I think you heal faster. And, you know, since then, I've had a chance to play for, you know, people in hospitals. I work with the American Association of Music Therapy, and so I'll go and play for, you know, different people in hospitals when I'm on the road. You know, I'll play for geriatric patients, pediatric patients, Alzheimer's patients, you know, psychiatric patients. I've been, and I'm playing for you guys.
Gary's thinking about that.
I want to know what other pictures you got under that desk, man. That freaked me out.
There's a couple I didn't bring that I now wish I had.
Thank you.
So after the accident, and then we went and you got all healed.
Yeah.
Then what happened after that? Because we're kind of trying to get up to the Grace Slick story.
Well, you know, I was a typical, you know, teenage kid that loved to play guitar all the time, and I was in a band.
Who were you listening to?
I was listening to a lot of Hendrix and Clapton and Santana and stuff.
There you go.
I was at that age group, you know, and...
So 15, 16 years old?
Yeah, exactly, 14, 15, 16, yeah. And at the age of 14, my English teacher asked me to come back after school. I thought I was in trouble, and he pulled a guitar out from under his desk. So I was asked to join this band with all these guys that were a lot older than me. And
how did he know about your music? Did you play?
I played at my school on the senior lawn. I was a freshman. That was the only way I could get on the senior lawn. Yeah. So he asked me to join this band with him, and everybody in the band was much older and had regular jobs, and the flute player was a barber, so he had access to hair products, and he got me a fake mustache. Yeah, because you couldn't play at the nightclubs at 14. So I would wear this really realistic fake mustache. And
I was one of those ones that went out like this.
No, it wasn't quite
that. Like
bad.
A Frito Bandito mustache.
No, it was
yeah,
some
right.
kind of a you know, normal mustache that a 14-year-old kid would
right.
have, you know, like
okay.
Man.
But you know, sometimes, you know, it would fall off in my drink, you know, my water. And I go, what's that hairy caliper in my drink? And I'd realize it was my mustache. And then
that's like a Pink Panther movie.
Oh my God.
It really is.
No, it would freak me out. And then the glue would drip down my face.
Nice.
And you could feel it, but you couldn't see it, really, until they turned a black light on stage one time. Like, what's up with that guy?
Right?
Yeah, oh yeah, I mean, I can even see it glowing.
It's I'll
like,
have wow. what he's having.
Yeah, give me yeah. one of those, you know?
So. Oh man, that's funny. Well, you were like 16 when Paul Kantner saw you, right?
Yeah, and Paul and Grace saw me because they were friends with my English teacher, Jack Traylor, who started my first band with me, and they asked us to do some songs on their solo album. So I was like playing with Jerry Garcia, Graham Nash, David Crosby, all these heroes. Yeah, and I'd go back home and ride my bicycle to school and think, wow, did that really just happen? And then so I got invited back.
I mean, really? I mean, were you fully cognizant of who these people were? I mean, when you
oh, absolutely. I mean, I was at Altamont, you know, in the crowd with binoculars looking at these people that, you know, less than a year later I was recording with. So it was all pretty...
What'd your friends say?
I don't even know if my friends really paid much attention to that.
I was going to say, yeah. What'd you do last night? Oh, I went to the football game. Yeah. I played with the, Hendrix.
No, well, it was really, it was definitely a wonderful experience being that young and being, you know, allowed to just play guitar. It's like, what's my job? Play guitar. Oh, I can do that, you know. So.
And you got paid for it.
Yeah, yeah.
Wow.
And then one thing led to another. We did a tour, my band with my English teacher and Jefferson Starship, and our band opened up for Starship, and I played in both bands. So I was the lead guitar player in both. And, you know, back then, people in the audience would be going, wait a minute, why does that guy look familiar? Yeah. Didn't we just
did
see
you
him?
Did you change clothes?
Yeah, I did.
Oh,
I did
okay.
change clothes.
Oh, man. Craig Chaquico is our guest. And he's gonna play a couple of the tunes for us here in a minute, including on something with that contraption up there. I don't know. Is that a cheese cutter? What is that?
I've never seen that before in my life.
Is that right? Well, it's a... Well, this really ought to be interesting,
it's
then.
Alien.
Exactly right. Exactly right. You want to tell us what you're going to
well,
be doing?
Well, you know, a lot of my songs over the years on my albums have had sort of a Native American theme to them. You know, like mm-hmm. songs about the eagle and the wolf and sacred ground, gathering of the tribes. And so I've been able to play for real gatherings of the tribes. And over the years, you know, having a chance to converse with some of these original people, and especially the elders and the singers that talk about their heritage and their history, it's really interesting because the conversation can go from Chief Joseph of the Nez Perce, who brought the Appaloosa horse breed into being and evaded the Calvary, to questions about, well, is the universe string theory or quantum? Is it waves or is it the vibrations?
Kelly was just asking me that earlier this morning.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah.
And I can cook too.
Yeah, I'm telling you. And then there'd be conversations about the Navajo rain versus the Hopi rain, and the Navajo rain being the really powerful, you know, dramatic
rain?
Thunder rain. Yeah, like today.
Like today. Wow. Okay.
And today's rain would be more of a Hopi rain, where it's more softer and more gentle and stuff. Yeah. And so talking to these people and being outside, you know, in the desert and watching thunderheads punch into the sky at sunset and, you know, flattening out into these big, almost spaceship-looking shapes, the conversation kind of led to aliens. And and apparently for thousands of years, they've talked about star people and about how, you know, it's not just us down here. There's another world. And so I don't know if it was the mushrooms and the pizza that night. Like, all right.
I don't know what the hell you're talking about, but we're going to take a break and come back, and he's going to play for us.
An alien.
Craig Chaquico. I'm Breakfast with Gary and Kelly. We'll be right back. Here on Breakfast with Gary and Kelly with our special guest, Craig Chaquico, who's comparing notes with Kelly about some
quantum
deep thinking.
Physics.
Yeah, that's, you know, the typical stuff that you would expect us to all be talking about.
Yes. Yeah.
But now.
And I, for some reason, after that experience, I've had these reoccurring dreams of aliens in lab coats that show up with laser beam instruments.
Oof. Well, here you go.
I mean, maybe that isn't more than a dream, after all.
You know,
dreams
hit it, baby.
That's right.
Exactly, exactly. Okay. Let her rip.
All right.
Thank you.
for a song here. All you, each laser beam is a different flute, and all you do is break the beam with your finger.
Is it okay if I have a ring on?
Yep, that's even better.
Really?
Look at you, sister.
Different flutes, yeah, different sounds.
What was that?
Oh, you broke the damn thing, Kelly. Just keep playing the thing, Kelly. Come on.
I can have so much fun with this. Okay, everybody. Channeling.
Perfect.
God, unbelievable. Wow. Who would have ever thought Kelly Bennett playing with Craig Chaquico?
Thank you.
Very nice. We're going to take a break. We'll be back with more Craig Chaquico and Breakfast with Gary and Kelly. You were good.
Oh,
you were good. We are back here on Breakfast with Gary and Kelly.
Wow. So do I come with you tonight on the stage and do a concert with you sometime?
Absolutely.
Do you, like, need my services?
Yeah, you know, we'll have your people call my people.
Okay. And we'll
so you get to leave when the show's over, but we've got to put up with her now. So this is not going to be an easy
thing. Hey, I think she was
very good.
She actually passed the audition with
really?
Colors. Oh, my God, you were great. I mean, it's the kind, yeah, right?
Wow.
You're going on the road, baby.
Well, yeah. Can you talk a little bit about this? Because it was simple. I mean, I could feel, well, not really feel it, but I can sense when
no,
you do.
No, seriously, you're
because
actually...
there's like three laser thingies going through on
exactly,
each side, right?
On each side, so there's six of
okay,
them, and
six.
You can program them to be different instruments, and it comes already programmed, and I use it in my concert, you know, like we had some fun with the alien and stuff, but it comes with a lot of different songs, and anybody that's ever wanted to be a musician or play and never learned uh-huh. to play an instrument can actually go in and wave their hands through the laser beams and create...
And different sounds, different instruments, like
guitars,
what?
Saxophones, bass drums, you know, I have
banjos?
A lot of flutes, there's even banjos in there, and there's kids' songs, too, so it's like
aww,
a lot of fun, you know?
That would be so cool for a kid to, like...
Yeah, so I've been working with the company here where the big music trade show is mm-hmm. happening this weekend, and so I've been helping with some of the music that they include in the package, and so I get a chance to come, you know... mess around
nice.
With and have fun. And you did great, man. You're,
thank you.
Yeah,
yeah, get her at the Beams booth at NAMM this afternoon, you know?
Well, Gary and I had kind of planned this without telling you, so you were kind of a...
Well, I was hoping it wasn't going to be the cowbell.
I think there's even cowbell.
I think we all were hoping that.
But thanks, that was fun. It's very easy to do.
Yeah, you were awesome. Thank you.
Thank you.
That's funny.
Thank you so much. Yeah.
That's
no,
funny stuff.
No problem.
Tell us about NAMM. Everybody hears about NAMM.
NAMM.
And not everybody can get into NAMM. So, I mean, what is it? It is essentially a trade show for guys like you. And
National Association of Music Merchants. Is
yeah, or
right?
manufacturers, oh. merchants, manufacturers.
Merchants.
I think you're right, merchants. And
yeah.
it's interesting because it brings every musical instrument company in the world
really
shows up to, you know, demonstrate their products. Their products and stuff. Right. So you have like everything from drums and
the cowbells.
I'm sure there's a huge cowbell section.
I'm gonna go to that.
You know, they have like almost a million people that show up to this thing. And to get in, you have to either be a merchant or maybe own a music store or a musician that plays some of the products. So it's like being a kid in a candy store when you walk in there, because you just see all these new products.
Techno toys.
Yeah.
Well, when I got this one for Kelly for Christmas, I figured stick with the name brand. So this is a Westinghouse. So I thought that really, you know what I'm saying?
That's a name that really
good. Exactly right. Tell us about some of the days that stuff with Starship. And I mean, it had to be. I mean, how many hotel rooms did you trash? Did you really do all that stuff? Did you do that stuff?
Is there a statute of limitations?
Yes,
on that?
My God, yes, there is. It was yesterday, so you're good.
I think he was a good boy, though.
No, I pretty much was. I was young enough.
You don't look like a trashy kind of guy that would do things nasty.
Well, did they?
I don't know what photos he's got.
Yeah, no. They're all gone. No, they're all gone. That's all of them. But they had to treat you a little differently, I would think, because of the age difference. Did they not? I mean, did they really?
Well, no, I felt that way. It actually felt that way because I was so much younger than everybody else. I sort of felt like they kind of looked out for me a little bit.
Yeah.
And by the time I joined the band, it seemed like most of the wild days were kind of behind them, you know?
Yeah.
And so I just got really fortunate to be in this situation where they would let me play guitar all the time.
Aww.
And so, I mean, my friends that partied in college partied a lot harder than I did back then.
Well, you were working.
But I'm making up for it now.
Yeah, well, there you go. Exactly.
So, tell me the time where you transitioned over from that, the rock music to jazz.
Well,
how did that happen?
You know, it wasn't like a conscious decision that I was going to change my style. And so many people were so nice earlier in the line to tell me that they've been listening to my music after that transition. I want to thank you again for taking the time to tell me that. But it wasn't like calculated, really. Mm-hmm. It was more like, you know, my wife got pregnant and the acoustic guitar was a lot more welcome around the house than the electric.
While she was pregnant or when she gave birth?
No, while she was pregnant.
Oh, okay.
During the pregnancy, little did I know that it would lead to, you know, getting played on KSBR and having number one albums and Grammy nominations in that category. And I to me, it's still just rock and roll, but it's a little bit different because it's on a more...
But you picked up an acoustic guitar and you just started playing it. And then all of a sudden, you started playing this music and you started writing, obviously, some of it.
Mm-hmm.
How did you conjure up that thing? You know what? I'm going to go this way.
Well, it was a natural evolution. It wasn't really conjured that much, except just to make, the kinds of records and music that I enjoyed. And back, you know, even in the Starship days when we had, like, some really big hits, it wasn't like the band sat down at a meeting and goes, all right, we're going to write a hit, and this album's going to be number one. And that stuff happened, but it wasn't conjured up. It was sort of like a natural...
Yeah,
it was more just like following your gut instincts and just trying to make a good record.
Yeah.
So that's... kind of what I
do you when you go into the studio, I mean, do you already have the thing in your head and you follow that path, or are you one of those guys that goes in there and kind of plays around and comes up with something, and or is it a combination?
No, it's really a combination. I mean, you hopefully, you know, have a template, you know, a beginning, middle, and end, and then there's always those really wonderful times where you're just kind of playing around and experimenting and you play something that you didn't expect you were going to play or didn't anticipate, and it turns out being a theme for the song. You know, those are the things I like the best. Those kind of like little surprises. Like,
oh, sure.
You know, I didn't write that. Where did that come from? You know?
Well, I don't want to forget it either.
Yeah,
Like, what was that?
No, seriously, that's true. And then there's those times where you walk in the studio and you feel like the guy, the painter, that can't figure out what paintbrush to use or what color or where to start on the canvas.
Writer's block.
Yeah, writer's block, yeah. So that happens sometimes,
too. It happens
to
me all the time.
Well, you did good today. I mean,
exactly. Yeah, that's
no writer's block.
Another guy that I wanted to ask you about and get some feedback on is Papa John Creech. I mean, just being in that, the stories had to be unbelievable from this guy.
Well, you know, that's true. And I'm not sure how many people know who Papa John Creech was, but he was this really talented older black guy that played violin in the band when I joined Starship. And I was still a teenager, and he was like in his 50s, which at the time seemed pretty old, but now... He's not that old, is it?
Really?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Now that I'm
this really old guy.
Yeah, well, you know, he seemed like...
I'd like to withdraw the question, Craig, for the love of God.
So, Papa John was this amazing musician that just could play so many styles of music, and he was on the violin with all these rock and rollers, you know. And there were some funny stories. Like, he'd talk in third person and say, you know, sometimes he would talk to me, because I was like the young kid in the band. He'd go, you know, Craig, sometimes Papa John will make a mistake on stage, and when he does,
he'll go and make the same mistake three times in a row. That way people think Papa John did it on purpose. He goes, that's where jazz, that's where jazz came from, he says. So
that's where jazz came from. Exactly.
So I've kind of used that theory a few times.
That's funny.
No, he was a really great guy.
Those were the great albums. I mean, what were those? Name them. I mean,
well, there's Dragonfly, Red Octopus, Earth, Spitfire. I don't know. And then we went into Freedom at Point Zero, Modern Times. So I can't. That's a memory question, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, yeah. Great stuff, man.
Yeah,
you are in the studio now.
Yeah, I'm working on a record now that's a little different. It's a little more blues based. I'm using some different singers and stuff on it. And thank you. And you know, if you've seen our show, we sort of have some fun in the audience with a great singer that can sing some of the songs I wrote for Starship. And he's kind of planted in the audience. Now, this is our secret, okay? Don't tell anybody. Don't put this on YouTube.
Okay.
But he pretends like he's part of the audience, and he asks for a Starship song, and I kind of play along with him and say, well, I can't sing it, but I can play it. And he's all, well, I can sing it. And then so,
really? So cool.
Yeah, and it's really fun.
I would love to do that.
Oh, it's hilarious.
Oh, Kelly, you've had your moment. My God, we created a monster.
I don't know how to sing, though. How cool is that?
No, it's really fun. Although, note to self, the first time we did it was a show with Minnie a Bear, and it was outdoor concert, and the security guys didn't know he was part of the band.
Oh, you're kidding.
No.
Yeah, so it got a little dicey there with him trying to get on stage and him trying to throw him off.
No, you don't have a wristband.
Yeah. So, you know, now we're trying to change it up. Sometimes he's not in the audience. Sometimes he is a security guy. And comes on stage and says,
oh, gosh,
hey.
That would be so funny.
Yeah, we had a lot of fun with it. We just tried to switch it up and make him
a chef in the kitchen next.
Yeah, he comes out and goes, hey, why don't you play some Starship? You know? why don't you make me an omelet?
There you go.
How far along are you on the new release?
We're a little more than halfway done. Although sometimes it's one of those things where you walk in the studio and you get that writer's block, and then there's those great times where it just all comes together. You know, that's pretty, you know, time consuming working with different studios and different artists across the country because you're sending stuff back and forth over the internet and different platforms.
Has it changed for you or what?
Wow, it really has. I mean, it's gotten to the point now where you can record with people like. The keyboard player for the Riffingtons, Bill Heller, has done a lot of work with me, and we've actually done sessions where he'll be on tour in Spain, you know, with the Riffingtons in a hotel room and sending me a keyboard solo that I'm back in my studio on the West Coast.
That is,
you know,
so
adding
odd.
To the song.
That is just so odd.
Yeah, I mean, there's still the interactions you have between each other, but those types of things where you can actually communicate across oceans, you know, and.
Yeah,
oh,
that's all right. The timing on that is not too bad because this is really screaming by this morning. We are.
Do we have to take a break?
Yeah, we do. We have to take a break. I'm sorry, your solo went so damn
no,
long,
I
Kelly. It was ridiculous.
That's why you never have a girl in the band, right?
But we're going to come back and Craig is going to play for us again. So please stick around here on Breakfast with Gary and Kelly with Craig Chaquico.
Thank you.
Kelly just moved me away from Craig because obviously she doesn't want to hear me on the beams because she knows I would kick booty.
Oh,
that, no,
wow.
I'm kidding.
We should have
no.
like a beam contest.
We should have a beams contest.
You should
we
be
should.
On one side and I'll be on the other.
We should. Man, have you guys had fun? This has been a fast morning, hasn't it?
It's
a great audience, isn't it?
Wait.
Craig,
isn't he awesome?
Really is.
I wish we could talk more.
Really is.
Thank you.
We're so grateful. You, just
blow the roof off this joint for us, would you, one last time here?
Yeah.
What are you going to play? You
know, I'm going to play the song that was on my very first album, Acoustic Highway. And it's like I like to tell people in concert, it's about any road that doesn't go to work. That's why it's such a happy song.
That's my song.
Yeah. And it's off my first record that you guys played.
Yep.
You know, it's almost 20 years now. It's almost
the
20th anniversary
cool.
coming up. So I'd like to play that and thank all of you for listening to my music.
Great
to
keep you everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Awesome.
That's Craig Chaquico, everybody.
Awesome. Thank you.